Spiritual ground is shaken, but when we confess our sins, God restores our foundation and builds us up in glory.
Most merciful God, we are too much like a foolish man to build his house on the sand. We are sinful in thought, word, and deed, by what we do and by what we fail to do. We are sinful from birth and are filled with evil. As a result,
forgives us because of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, our Savior. He establishes us on the foundation of his love and makes us firm in faith. Therefore, I declare to you that all your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Old Testament reading comes to us from Isaiah 51, 1 through 3. Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness, you who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, that I might bless him and multiply him. For the Lord comforts Zion, he comforts all here, wastes places, and makes her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Our epistle reading comes to us from 1 Corinthians 3, 10 through 15. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. For one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. And if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire.
Gospel comes from Matthew, the 7th chapter. Jesus said, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." Here is reading the gospel.
Praise to you, Christ.
Is I can't get the computer to print out my my sermon, so I'm going to have to preach from the server, from the computer. So different day. How's that? You can do that next tomorrow if you like. So we have any builders here? Anybody that's done some building? Yeah, several of you. Okay. it's become kind of an avocation for me. I've remodeled a basement in one house, and I'm now working on another one and finding out about how difficult, well, not difficult, but I mean, how many things you have to do and do correctly. I'm mostly self-taught, but when I get stuck, thank goodness for YouTube. You can find almost everything on YouTube. So I fancy myself a little bit of a builder, not much, but a little bit. Well, Jesus gives us a story about two builders, not two dreamers who talk about someday building their dream home. Now, Jesus gives us two people who built, not two philosophers who go on and on about the value of a place we might call home. Jesus gives us builders. Not even architects who can draw a nice home on paper. It's important that we recognize this. In giving us builders, Jesus is talking about doing, about acting. Now, both people in Jesus' parallel stories here built. They make something. In this case, a house. Or houses, I should say. Jesus is not talking about theology here, or creeds, or doctrine, or anything else, but actual practice. Another thing about the two builders in Jesus' story, and they have this in common. Besides being practical people of action, is that their homes are both tested by the forces of nature. The quality of both buildings will be measured by their ability to withstand the assaults of storms, high winds, and water. These two builders are building in a real world where storms can take down a house in a matter of seconds. We've all seen that on the news when a tornado or a hurricane blows through. So what's the difference between builders? What's the difference between these two? Well, the first one, Jesus tells us, is wise. And the second one is rather foolish, Jesus says. That's how Jesus contrasts the two builders. And what makes this first builder wise? He builds his house on rock. Well, the foolish builder builds his house on sand. That's the difference. Rock and sand. Rock is, as you know, hard and solid. Sand is soft and shifting. And a foolish builder can expect their house Foolish builders expect their house to stand on shifting sand. The wisdom of both builders is measured by their building's durability in a storm. One lasts, the other fails. We need to be careful here in interpreting Jesus' story of the two builders. This is not a story comparing those who follow Jesus and those who do not follow Jesus. As Jesus spells out the meaning of his story, he makes it clear that both builders represent people who hear these words of mine, as he says. It's not a matter of one hearing Jesus teach and the other one completely missing it. Both listen to Jesus teach. Today we might say that both builders, the wise and the foolish, represent people who read the words, perhaps read the words in red in their New Testaments. Both listen to the sermons, and both may participate in Bible study. They know what Jesus taught. Even more, they may understand his teaching. So, what's the difference between these two listeners? The wise one listens to Jesus teach, understands his teaching, and puts it in practice. As Jesus puts it, this one hears these words of mine and does them. The foolish one, in contrast, hears Jesus teach, grasps his teaching, but never does what Jesus says. In other words, this listener to Jesus' teaching hears these words of mine, but does not do them. So, the story of the two builders is really a story about what Jesus expects from those who listen to him teach and preach. He wants more than showing up to hear him. He wants more than praise for his valuable insights. He wants more than an impressive theological library or list of truths and values to which we subscribe. He wants a life, your life, based on his teachings. He wants us to do what he's told us to do. He wants us to do his will even when it's difficult, even when the storms rage. We've been looking at Jesus' Sermon on the Mount all Lent. And Jesus' Sermon on the Mount is not so much an ideology or philosophy. It is a blueprint, perhaps, for living a Christ-like life. His practical teachings show us how to navigate our relationships in Christ-like ways. Sermon on the Mount is meant to show itself in how we live our life on a day-in and day-out basis, whether it's a different day or a normal day. When life is easy, when life is hard, it's not just about what we believe, but how we live it. In the ancient Greek world, there was an ascending staircase of maturity. It went from knowledge to understanding to wisdom. Knowledge was learning certain truths. Understanding was grasping those truths so you could actually articulate them. Wisdom, though, was putting those truths into practice, doing them. Jesus is saying here that wisdom is putting his teachings into practice. So imagine for a moment that you get sick, really sick. I mean, sick to where your life is at stake. Your physician prescribes a treatment that includes a protocol of specific medications, surgery, and diet. Respect your doctor. She is a respected authority on treating your illness. You may ask for a second opinion, but wisdom would dictate that you follow her prescription. You'll take those pills, have the surgery, follow the diet, just as she says. It would be foolish to ignore her, and likely just as foolish to follow your own opinion. It's like that with Jesus' teachings. They are meant to be done, not just talked about. He wants us to come to him in prayer. He wants us to be forgiven and to forgive. He wants us to love our enemies and help those who are poor. He wants us to make peace and show mercy. He expects us to salt the earth and brighten the dark places of this world. The early followers of Jesus understood this wisdom approach to Jesus' teaching. James writes a letter that we must be doers of the word and not only hearers. Luther liked to think James got that backwards, but nonetheless, Luther would say we still hear, we receive, we are forgiven. We receive grace, but out of that grace, we go and we do. We get to, as one of my friends likes to say when he preaches. We now listen to the words of Jesus in the shadow of the cross as we approach ever closer to Calvary. You want to go to college, or to Canada, I suppose, but Calvary is located in Jerusalem, as you know. That cross of love and sacrifice have become a motivation to build our lives on what Jesus has taught. We practice what Jesus teaches not out of fear of judgment or out of strict obedience, but out of love and gratitude. As we watch him weather the storm of his passion, we see him practicing what he taught: humility, reconciliation, forgiveness, prayer. He withstood the storm with his own amazing grace and strength. And he did that for us. No wonder printing his words in red makes so much sense for many people. He spilled his real red blood when he suffered and died for us. His love constrains us to be not just good listeners to his words, but dynamic listeners, who build on rock, putting his words to work, and trusting that the gates of hell will not prevail against us. Amen.
Thank you.
storms of life tear us down, build us back up in you. When our sin tears down another person, forgive us so that we are both built back up in you. When it seems impossible to put back together the pieces of our lives, build us back up in you. When storms tear us down,
build us back up on the foundation of your word.
Lord Jesus, your church is the place where you give gifts that build up rather than tear down. Draw us to you week in and week out, so we are strong to face any adversity that may come our way. When storms tear us down,
build us back up on the foundation of your firm word.
Lord Jesus, we live in a sinful world, and sometimes governments tear down rather than build up. Please provide leaders in our world and in our nation that will provide and help or provide help and protection for the poor, for the needy, the oppressed. Use the structure of governments everywhere to provide resources that lay a firm foundation for peaceful life in this world. When storms tear us down,
build us back up on the foundation of your firm word.
Lord Jesus, sometimes our bodies are torn down by the impact of sickness and disease. It is at those times we need you to strengthen us and bring back the foundation of good health for our bodies. According to your will, bring health and healing to all those we know who have been torn down by illness. When storms tear us down,
build us back up on the foundation of your firm word.
Lord Jesus, the ultimate destroyer is death, but you have provided a way to life everlasting. When our bodies die, you give us new and eternal life. Thank you for the gift and witness of the faithful Christians who have gone before us. Make their lives a witness and a testimony to your amazing love. When storms tear us down,
build us back up on the foundation of your firm word.
In your hands, Lord Jesus, we place all of our needs, knowing that you use your word to reconstruct us and build us up for our good and for your glory.
Amen.
Remember, as we pray the Lord's Prayer, the first half is the contemporary, second half somehow is the traditional. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
God give you the grace and strength to take up the cross and follow Christ. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.